Functional programming, like object-oriented programming, is a way of writing programming code. Object-oriented paradigm and functional paradigm are not conflicting with each other, so you can apply both and program. Before I explain what functional programming is, let's look at an example where you can feel why we use it. You can find the example codes of this video on the Notion page linked in the pinned comment. First, here's a JavaScript code written in a non-functional way. At the top, you see an array of numbers like this. Pick out only the even numbers from these numbers first, then put them into a different array, square each one of them, and then add up all the results to output the total on the console. Prior to that, it prints each one in the console during the process of filtering out even numbers and squaring each of these like this. So when you paste this code into the console and run it, you get a result like this. You can open the console window of Chrome and Edge using these shortcuts. This is an example of procedural code, which is not functional, and this is how the code looks like when written in a functional style, as shown on the right. You can see the exact same execution result with this code.
It's much shorter now, isn't it?
The first thing that stands out is that the code is much more concise, but that's not really the main point. Shortening long code can also be achieved with other programming paradigms, such as object-oriented, and code written functionally is not always more concise. The important difference lies here. Procedural codes, like the example on the left, if portrayed as a picture, would look something like this. On the other hand, functional codes, like the ones on the right, can be likened to this.
On the left side, there seem to be various things connected. On the right side, it's made so that something enters one hole and comes out the other side.
Yes. If you look at code that has been written procedurally, you can see that it uses many variables. In other words, this program has states that can vary at each point in time. On the other hand, functional programming minimizes the use of variables as much as possible. The use of many variables means that there is a lot of potential for mistakes and problems. Just like how machines with many buttons and various controls require careful handling, so does this. Variables can influence the task that the code performs, and in turn, can be influenced by that task. Consequently, the code that uses such variables outputs different results every time it's executed, making it tricky to predict and test. Also, as the number of variables increases, there is a greater potential for issues like developer mistakes or unintentional value changes during their use. In multi-threading processes, there can be problems caused by multiple threads accessing the same variable at the same time, and efforts to prevent this can also decrease the efficiency of parallel processing. In functional programming, we write code in a way that minimizes the use of variables as much as possible. Of course, it's impossible to program software completely without variables, but in functional code, these variables are hidden within already written functions, so they're not explicitly seen in the code. In this example code, there are also procedurally written codes using variables within these classes and methods.
So, functional programming is all about minimizing the situation where a developer directly handles variables.
You can understand it that way. Now, let's dive into functional programming in earnest. Among programming languages, there are languages that are created for functional programming, while others may not be made specifically for it, but can be used for functional programming without any problems. And then, there are languages where it's quite tricky to perform functional programming within the language itself. This classification can vary depending on the criteria, so it's not absolute. I'll talk more about languages dedicated to functional programming when we cover advanced topics later on. The programming languages you use usually belong to these two categories. The distinction between them lies in whether functions are first-class objects. A first-class object means it can be treated like regular data, such as numbers. It means that they can be assigned to variables, inserted into arrays, they can also become parameters in functions, become a return value, can be made anonymously. For example, in JavaScript, you can put a function like this into a variable or constant as a value. Functions can be used as data, just like other primitive values or objects. However, methods in Java cannot be used in such a way. Java methods can't exist on their own. So, to do functional programming in Java, you have to use workaround alternatives like Lambda expressions and the Stream API. We'll delve deeper into this after we cover the topic of object-oriented programming. In this video, we're going to take a look at the principles of functional programming using JavaScript so you can directly run examples of your Notion page using the developer tools in your browser. First off, in functional programming, pure functions are used. A pure function refers to a function that always returns the same result for the same input values, regardless of when and how many times it is executed. This add function, for example, always return 7 when we run it with 3 and 4 as arguments. Pure functions don't influence or get influenced by any values other than their parameters. They are very much like craftsmen making the same pottery every time with the given materials, without caring about the world outside. Because they never interfere with the external world, pure functions don't cause side effects, which are changes in external data, regardless of how many times they are executed. For the same reason, in functional programming, we do not modify the original data that exists. If there is a need to modify the existing data, we always make a copy and work on that. In a case where an element needs to be added to this array, if you use the push method like this on the original, the array itself is modified. In functional programming, we don't leave traces on the original by creating and using a new array with the added elements like this. The same goes for modifying objects. The modifications are always applied by making a copy, and this is the principle of immutability. For instance, the functional code that I showed you initially, if you print the original array after execution, you can see that the content remains unchanged. Therefore, due to leaving no trace of execution, functional codes are easy to predict and test, and are also advantageous for tasks such as change history management and caching. Referential transparency is deeply related to these two principles. The call statement of functional code can be replaced by its return value. This add function, written as an arrow function, returns the sum of the two given parameters, as we saw earlier. Therefore, the result of executing add with 3 and 4 is 7. Changing all add 3, 4 in this code to 7 gives the same results. This is possible because the add function is a pure function, and the execution of the function does not cause any changes externally. The most widely used form in practical programming, in functional programming, is the higher order function. Higher order functions refer to functions that take other functions as parameters or output as a return value. Conversely, a function that goes into another function as an argument is called a callback function. It's possible because the language treats functions as first-class objects. In this example, there are two functions, apply operation and add. If you look at the call section of apply operation, you can see that add function is entered as an argument. Therefore, the apply operation function is the higher order function and the add function is the callback function. The apply operation function fetches the first and second arguments as two numbers and runs them by putting them into the callback function fetched as the third argument. If you had put in a multiplication function instead of an addition function as an argument, it would have returned 12, not 7. These kind of codes that we often see in web development are utilizing callback functions. You give a callback function as an argument to imply execute this function after 1 second or when a certain button is clicked. Here is a simplified version of the functional example that we saw earlier. High-order function methods such as filter, map, and reduce of collections like this array are typical examples of functional programming. These higher-order functions handle items within the collection based on given callback functions. The filter allows only values that return true from the given callback function. Map changes each value to the return value when passed as an argument to the callback function. Lastly, reduce folds items into a single value using the callback function. Most modern programming languages provide features to handle collections functionally like this. In languages like Java, you can do this kind of work using libraries like the Stream API.
So, we can freely use this thing called functional programming because basically the language or library provides these features, right?
Right. Since complicated procedures are already programmed, we can write code functionally like this just by learning how to use them. I've told you high-order functions not only accept functions as arguments, but can also return them. This compose function is an example of a function that returns a function. It takes two callback functions as arguments and returns a function that executes all the callback functions in order on the given value. Therefore, if you put the add1 function, which adds 1 to the given value, and the double function, which doubles the given value, into the compose function as callback functions, a function that adds 1 to the given value and then doubles it is returned like this. And if you execute that function with 3 as an argument, it returns 8. With high-order functions, you can easily do sophisticated operations such as combining 2 or more functions to create a new one. In this video, we've explored what functional programming is, along with its basic principles. We will deal with more complex and challenging concepts related to functional programming in the following videos. Then, I will see you in the next video.